First Peter chapter 1 verse, verse 15 as we begin today. But just as he who called you is holy, so be holy in all that you do. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your holiness. Thank you that before us who have sinned by action and are sinners by nature, we have this example of a holy God. And yet, Lord, we know that the measure of holiness that you represent and that you are, we will never attain. And thank you for the grace that you've given us in Christ Jesus to count us holy so that we have the right forever to entrance to your kingdom, to spend time to dwell with you. That even today as we worship you, in your community, in your church, we have right to come boldly to the throne of grace, and you're present here with us, not because we've done anything righteous, but because you are holy and Christ has substituted as our holiness, and he has been the one that has taken away our sins, and you count us holy because Christ is holy. And Lord, that everything that we would say and do today might keep in mind the wonderful work of Jesus Christ on our behalf. Thank you, Jesus, for being willing to suffer and die as our holy sacrifice. And Lord, that we can have life because of you. But now, as we together look into the scriptures and at this command to be holy in ourselves, Lord, help us to understand that in the midst of this gracious favor that you have for us, that we do indeed have responsibility. May the Holy Spirit have free rein this morning to take the word of God and to apply it to each one of our own lives, and to do so in such a way, Lord, that we would experience you and to know you deeper and better as we go from this place today. And in all ways, may we magnify the name of Jesus. It's in his name we pray. Amen. Well, I'm going to begin again today by asking you to take a test. Now, if you'll take out your sermon notes, you'll see right away that I have a little test there at the beginning of your sermon. And basically, it's this. What characteristics would you like people to describe you with? And I've got six characteristics listed there. I like to be described by some of these characteristics, mind you. And by the way, if you number these characteristics, there's no right or wrong. Although if any men are out there and they put pretty or something like that, there is going to be an issue. And even though this is kind of outcome-based, that would be a problem. But I would like you to just take a second and number those in relationship to what adjectives you would like people to describe you with. What do you want to be known as? Do you want to be kind, smart, pretty, handsome, mature, or strong? Frankly, if you want to think about me, I'd like you to think about me as being smart, handsome, strong, all right? Those are the three ones that I think I would mark down first. I think mature would be a desire. I don't think it would fit. But I think those are the ones that would fit me mostly. But now I want you to do something. Now, I'm assuming most of the women put pretty, smart, and kind. That's my guess. And I'm going to check afterwards to see if I'm right. But now you have a blank there in the quotation marks. And I want you to write the word holy right in there. Holy. Where would you put in the list of adjectives that describe what you would like people to think about you, where would you put the word holy? Would you like other people to say, oh, yes, he or she is a holy person? Is that a good adjective to describe you? How about you that are younger in here today and you're thinking about getting married someday? What type of woman, what type of man would you like to marry? Did the idea of holiness ever enter your mind? I want my future husband to be holy. I want my future wife to be a holy person. that's contingent upon what you think a holy person is. What do you think a holy person is today? Someone who doesn't do anything fun. A lot of us think that. Or maybe somebody that doesn't do anything. Or someone that is very religious, fasts and prays all the time. Someone who looks religious, you know, has a long beard and wears robes and crosses and stuff like that. That's a holy person. Kind of like a monk that lives within a cave. Living in a hole, by the way, never made anyone holier. And there were the old monks that were the pole dwellers, where back, and I remember, I believe his name was Simon Stylites, and he lived for a year on a pole, about 30 feet off the ground. He lived on the pole, and because he lived on a pole and not in a hole, people thought he was holier because he lived on the pole. Now, I decided I was going to ask my grandkids what they thought a holy person was. And I was really looking for something cute, and I didn't get a lot of that. I was very surprised at what they said. But one, and this is the cutest one, but one of them said that a holy person is a person that believes in God and the Bible, trusts in Him, believes the Bible is true, and gives things to God. They kept going on and on. Reads their Bible, loves God, and this is good. Ask God to help them be in their heart through lots of stuff. An example: believe that God keeps you safe when you're camping, you know, with all the dark and the howling animals. Another one said, it is to be without sin. And this is where I think our Sunday school training comes in. And I believe this child's only 8 or 9 years old. You have to ask my wife what their ages are. Without sin, very obedient, follows God. But nobody's holy but God. But if they say somebody's holy, it means he's really a good guy and does lots of good things and doesn't do anything bad. In Sunday school, we learn holy means to be set apart for God. Another one said nobody's holy, but it means to be without blame and without sin. Some call priests holy, and they should be because they know more about the Bible. But you shouldn't worship them. To be holy is to be just like God. One other one said, only one person was holy, and that person was Jesus. I think that's pretty good. That's certainly a good place to start. For the Apostle Peter today, as we are going through the Cephas mandates, and Cephas, of course, is Peter's Hebrew name, but as we go through these, this idea of holiness is not some weird religious lifestyle or something very strange, some type of escapism from society, but something that each and every Christian in here should be passionate about in our lives. And holiness is something that even a little child can understand. It's not some far-out concept. We all should understand what it means, and we should have a deep desire to be holy people, no matter how that sounds in the 21st century. Well, what is holiness? And if you look at your notes, first off, holiness is the constant pursuit of God's character. Holiness is the constant pursuit of the character of God. Look at verse 15 of 1 Peter chapter 1 again. But just as he who called you is holy, so be holy in all you do. And verse 16, for it is written, be holy because I am holy. Like Father, like Son. Because it describes the character of God, it should describe the children of God as well. He says, but just as he who called you is holy, so be holy. Remember back in the first couple verses of this book, he writes this letter to God's elect, to those that have been chosen by God. And what he says is that just because the one that called you is holy, now you have to be holy. In other words, God calls you into personal relationship with him, not just because it's a great idea, not just because it's something good, but because he has very distinct purpose for those people that he calls to be in relationship with him. It is not just about being religious and attending church and doing religious stuff. That's not really holiness. Holiness, according to this text, is exactly what God is and what God would be if he was standing here in the flesh, as he was in the example of Jesus Christ. So be holy, he says, in all you do, because God is holy. In other words, holiness isn't just one aspect of your Christian life. Holiness encompasses everything about your Christian life. In other words, when you get up in the morning and you begin to go about your routine of the day, the Bible here tells us that in everything that we do, we are to demonstrate holiness. How about you? Is that on your mind and heart when you get up in the morning? I'll tell you, most mornings when I get up after supposedly a good night's sleep, the first thing I'm thinking about is not holiness. In that, he says here, it is the command to be holy in all that you do. If you look at the scriptures, actually this passage of scriptures begins in verse 15 when he calls us to the holiness of God. It really doesn't end till chapter 2, verse 12. And we're going to get to some of those verses right at the end there in a little bit. But he goes on to explain what this holiness is if you look at in verses 17 to 21. And he's got a reason, and what he's really trying to do is prove to you why you need to be a holy person and why holiness needs to be on your heart and mind. Look at verse 17. He says, "Since you call on a Father who judges each man's work impartially, live your lives as strangers here in reverent fear." In other words, we've got to be mindful of some reasons why God wants us to be a holy people. What are those reasons? Verse 18, "For you know that it was not with perishable things such as silver or gold that you were redeemed from the empty way of life handed down to you from your forefathers." And it is interesting, he says, it's interesting that you weren't redeemed with things that were perishable, such as gold or silver. You know, we think gold or silver is some pretty good stuff when it comes down to created things. But he's saying here, you know, you weren't redeemed with such perishable issues, such as gold or silver. In verse 19, he says, "But with the precious blood of Christ, a lamb without blemish or defect." Okay, be holy because I am holy. You were redeemed by the precious blood of Jesus. He was the Lamb of God who had no blemish or defect in himself. Be holy because Christ was holy. Look at verse 20. "He was chosen before the creation of the world." You were chosen, right? He was chosen before the creation of the world, but was revealed in these last times for your sake. Through him you believe in God, who raised him from the dead and glorified him, and so your faith and your hope are in God. So what is he saying here? He's saying here that you need to be holy people because you really are considering the fact that all that Jesus did, as was foreordained by the Father, was for you. And if we don't desire then to be holy people, we are tarnishing and disrespecting the sacrifice of Jesus. We're not really considering all that he went through as this perfect Lamb of God for our salvation. And so because of that, we need to be holy. Well, we need to decide what this holiness is. What does it mean to be holy people? What if we're called to be holy? And we're supposed to get up in the morning and say, "Lord, I want to be holy in all that I do because you've called me and chosen me to be a holy person." I think we're going to have to understand exactly what that holiness is. Well, let's go back in the Old Testament to where Peter got this command. Now, it's written in a lot of places, but probably the most significant area of scripture is in the book of Leviticus. Most of you thought that the book of Leviticus had little value for a lot of things today, but I would like you to see how the writer of Leviticus, which was Moses, how he describes this issue of holiness. So go to Leviticus, and go to Leviticus chapter 19. Leviticus chapter 19. And first look at verses 1 and 2. For here the Lord said to Moses, verse 2 now, speak to the entire assembly of Israel and say to them, be holy because I, the Lord your God, am holy. Be holy because I, the Lord your God, am holy. Now, I'm going to choose some of these verses. This goes on for several chapters, and I would like you to see some of the examples of holiness in relationship to what Moses taught the Israelites, what God told Moses to teach the Israelites. Go down and look, for example, at verse 14. Here, holiness relates to the way that we treat those less unfortunate in ourselves. Do not curse the deaf or put a stumbling block in front of the blind, but fear your God, I am the Lord. That's holiness. To be kind and considerate of those that are less fortunate. Go down to verse 17. Do not hate your brother in your heart. Rebuke your neighbor frankly so you will not share his guilt. In other words, when you see your neighbor, when you see your brother or sister in Christ doing something that doesn't line up with the standards of God's word, what does he say? If you really want to not share in that person's guilt or be guilty along with them, you will say something to them. You will say something. Rebuke your neighbor frankly so you won't share his guilt. And that really relates to the brothers and sisters in Christ in the church. Look at verse 19. Keep my decrees. Do not mate different kinds of animals. Do not plant your field with two kinds of seed, and do not wear clothing woven of two kinds of material. And in that day, and in relationship to the ceremonial and the health issues and different things like that, and some designs that God has for creation, that these commands specifically fit those eras. And so, you know, this isn't something where you've got to get up every day and make sure you put on all cotton and you don't mix wool and cotton in anything. And we'll talk about that in a second. But look down at verse 27 now. Here's some more exhortations to holiness. Do not cut the hair at the sides of your head or clip off the edges of your beard. See, if you don't do that, you're not holy. Do not cut your bodies for the dead or put tattoo marks on yourselves. I am the Lord. See, those were the practices of the pagan cultures around. And because they were the practices of the pagan cultures, it wasn't necessarily that these practices were evil in themselves, but because they were the practices of the pagan culture, what God is saying is, I don't want you to do these things because you will look like the pagans, and I want you to understand that you're supposed to be different. Do not degrade your daughter by making her a prostitute, or the land will turn to prostitution and be filled with wickedness. Observe my Sabbaths and have... Oh, by the way, verse 29, you say, well, we don't do that today. Consider some of the parents of some of the Hollywood children. You can read the stories. Verse 30. Observe my Sabbaths and have reverence for my sanctuary. I am the Lord. Do not turn to mediums or seek out spiritists, for you will be defiled by them. I am the Lord your God. And look at verse 32. I love this one. Rise in the presence of the aged, show respect for the elderly, and revere your God. When was the last time you stood up when I came into the room? Go over to chapter 20, verse 22. I want you to see how serious this is for the Israelites and for God. Chapter 20, verse 22. He says, keep all my decrees and laws and follow them so that the land where I am bringing you to live may not vomit you out. You must not live according to the customs of the nations I am going to drive out before you. Because they did all these things, I abhorred them. But I said to you, you will possess their land, and I will give it to you as an inheritance, a land flowing with milk and honey. I am the Lord your God, who has what? He has set you apart from the nations. Let that go deep into your conscience today. That God has called you as his people to set you apart from the people in the world today. That's what holiness is really all about. And even though these Old Testament commands combined moral and ceremonial and health and national laws and things like that, today we don't necessarily look at all of these commands and say these are exactly what we do today, because paganism has taken a different form today. And we also know that we don't live under a Christian government, and most governments in the world aren't Christian today anyway. And so what becomes most important for us as Christians is not the ceremony or the national laws or the health laws, but really the laws that deal with the moral issues of what it means to be righteous. Well, what is holiness in the New Testament sense? It's very similar to this Hebrew word, gadash, in the Old Testament, which means to be set apart, to be hallowed, to be considered sacred. And so the first understanding of holiness in the scriptures means to be made different. And to be made different as to be set apart for the worship and the purposes of God. That's what Old Testament holiness is. Now, in the New Testament, the word hagios means almost the same thing. Specifically, to be separated to God from sin. And if you notice in your sermon notes there, you got two empty blanks. Literally, to be consecrated and to be sacred. In other words, when you came into a relationship with Jesus Christ, at that point, God takes your life and he sets you apart as a sacred instrument, a sacred vessel, chosen to be holy or separated unto him for his purposes. See, that's where we begin to struggle with Christianity, don't we? Especially as we're growing up. We're not so sure we don't want to fit in, and yet God says you need to be set apart. W.E. Vine and his expository dictionary of New Testament, or Greek dictionary of New Testament words, says holiness is characteristically defined in Scripture as God-likeness. The issue is this: do you really want to be like Jesus? We all say, you know, I really want to be like Christ. I want to live out my relationship as a Christian, my relationship with God, by becoming more and more like Jesus. Do you really want to be like Jesus? Jesus, according to the Bible, was holy. But our problem is now that we start thinking too often about what holiness isn't, remember that holiness isn't just a matter of not doing things that the pagans do to make us different. But holiness is described as in terms of what we're set apart to do. And this is where you get the exciting dimensions of holiness. In other words, God's not saying, hey, I've placed you within the world so that you can't do anything. You're just going to have to sit home and study the scriptures and pray all the time. That's really not what it is. Because holiness is something that you're called upon in a very exciting way to do before the Lord and in the culture that God has called you to live in. Let me give you this definition. I wrote this down within your sermon notes because I think this opens the doors up for a greater understanding of what holiness is, because God has called you to be holy and he's called you with purpose in our society. Peter J. Madden said it this way: an inward burning with love and compassion, zeal and fervor, prayer and praise, righteous anger against Satan and all of his works, that's paganism, and a holy desire to see the kingdom of God established and growing. See, it's not just a matter of what you don't do, it's a matter of what you do. You're called and chosen of God to go out into our culture and to be like God. And when someone encounters you in your life, the way that you live, they ought to encounter some of the characteristics of your Father in heaven. What adjectives would people use to describe you? Well, I believe what Madden says. And it's time in our culture that we go on the offensive for holiness. for God's holiness. I saw a program a couple weeks ago, a little over a week ago, on this Body Works thing down at the museum. And number one, when I first heard it, I thought it was just odd and strange. And the more, and I watched this program about the whole process that they go through to take these dead bodies that people were living in and take them and prepare them and plasticize them so that they can go on display in museums all over the world. It's become a giant moneymaker. And they've got issues because now some of these bodies they believe are a lot of them are coming from China and they're criminals that were killed by the government, and they're not necessarily, they don't even have permission to be using them for these purposes. But when you think about what we're doing and considering what the human body is, this is degrading. This is degrading. This isn't right. Matter of fact, they interviewed a guy who they asked the question. They said, "Doesn't this bother you?" He was probably in his late 20s, early 30s. They said, "Doesn't this bother you?" And he says, "Oh, no, this doesn't bother me. The body is just a piece of meat." Well, isn't that exactly what the abortionists say about the unborn child? Isn't that the same thing? And I'll tell you what, we can do a lot of things in making models in certain things. If we made models that were almost as good as those real live bodies and we put up that display down at the museum, it would get a fraction of the amount of people to go visit it. Why are people visiting it? Because we are a culture of death. We are a culture that thinks about death. We are a culture that fantasizes and likes things that have to do with death instead of life. And so what do we need to do as Christians? We need to learn that we have to stand up for what is holy, what is just, what is right. And we need to learn to go on the offensive, not just sit back and let people think that Christianity's all about what we don't do. But stand up for the righteousness of God. Stand up for the character of Christ. Our holiness needs to outwardly challenge people to the righteousness of God. Never think that the people out there in our culture that don't know Christ are okay. Never think that those that even go to church week after week but haven't received Christ's sacrifice for their sins as people that are okay. They're not okay. And God has called you to be a burning light to reach them by displaying who he is in their presence. It was John Wesley who answered the question, "Why do so many people come out and see you?" And of course, he was kicked out of the traditional church and he would preach outside. And thousands and thousands of people would come to listen to him preach. Here's his answer. He says, "Every morning I set myself on fire and people come for miles to watch me burn." The burning separation to God's character. How about you when you get up in the morning? Maybe it's time to get out the lighter and set yourself on fire so your employees, those that work with you, your schoolmates, your friends, your bosses, can watch you burn all day. That's what it means to be holy. A separation to God's character to reveal God's character to the world. Now we get into point number two, that holiness reflects God's ownership to the world. Holiness reflects God's ownership to the world. What's he saying? Go to 1 Peter again, chapter 2. This is the section that kind of concludes this whole area in 1 Peter about holiness, and this is how he's going to conclude it. And he uses the language of his chosen nation, Israel. 1 Peter 2, we're going to start reading in verse 9. "But you," that's you, "are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people belonging to God, that you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness into a wonderful light." Underline that you may declare the praises of him. See, holiness goes on the offense. Verse 10. Once you were not a people, but now you are the people of God. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. Dear friends, I urge you as aliens and strangers in the world to abstain from sinful desires which war against your soul. Live such good lives among the pagans that though they accuse you of doing wrong, they may see your good deeds and glorify God on the day that he visits us. What's he saying? In this language that comes right out of the Jewish nation and his relationship to them and his calling of them, he says that you now are, as Christians, you as the chosen people of God, who are the unique possession of God within the world, are to be his representation to the world. That's your purpose, to represent God to the world. Charles Spurgeon said this, that holiness is the architectural plan upon which God builds up his living temple. Now, we talked about that in our series dealing with the supremacy of Christ, that God is building a holy temple. It has nothing to do with the building. He has everything to do with us as the body of Christ. And he's building up this holy temple so that when people encounter visually and in every way this holy temple whom you are, they will be drawn to understand and know the living God. And so we're supposed to be different. And if you saw those verses back in Leviticus, different in almost every way from the culture around us. We're called to be different types of people. You might say, you know, if I live like that, if I'm that different, people are going to consider me strange. We'll look at verse 12. Live such good lives among the pagans that though they accuse you of doing wrong. In other words, they look at you and say, well, there's something wrong with you. You know, you don't fit in. You know, you're not tolerant. See, our society wants everybody to really be the same. And while we talk about tolerance, and it's interesting in our culture, we talk about tolerance, what they mean is they'll be tolerant of everybody that lines up with their values. If you don't line up with the values of those in our pagan culture, then you're not going to be tolerated. That's why Christians aren't tolerated within our culture today, because they do not line up with the pagan culture. And they are going to criticize us because, well, what? You act like you know what's true. You act like you know what's right. You act like you know what God is like and what that means. Don't you understand that there are religions all over the world? And all religions are equal, and they all help people get to God. They understand the Cambodians in Buddhism if you think they're all equal. They're not. One is true. It says they are going to accuse you of doing wrong. People are thinking I'm strange. Well, did you ever look at those in our culture with all the rings? And the nose rings and the tongue rings and all those things that lend themselves toward the issue of pseudomasochism, don't you think that's a little strange too? But they'll think we're strange. You live in the world as aliens, the Bible said. Look at verse 11. We're actually working backwards. Dear friends, I urge you as aliens and strangers in the world. In other words, never get to the place where you can settle down. I know we all need to live in homes, we need to buy food, we need to work out jobs. But in the midst of that, always realize that this is temporary. We're not going to be here forever. Our home's in heaven. We're called aliens. Did you ever see for the guys that like sci-fi comedy, the movie Men in Black? It's all about aliens. And in there you find out that it was, in fact, Elvis was an alien, and that's why he did the things that he did. But these aliens spent all their time trying to fit in and to be a normal part of culture. But in the end, it was discovered that they were really beating to the tune of a different drummer. And they really couldn't fit in because they were aliens. And too many Christians today are trying to fit into the culture. And according to the scripture, we are not to fit into the culture to win the culture. That the way that we win the culture is by demonstrating the holiness of God in our lives and everything that that means in a pagan culture. Holiness is not a spiritual quest that those around you are going to be able to understand. Sin issues are important to us. Why? Because everything that God is against sin. Verse 11, to abstain from sinful desires which wage war against your soul. See, that's important to us. It's important to us, not important to the world. And we live differently, but you know what? We live differently, but we don't live indifferently because we're owned by God. Look at verse 10. Once you were not a people, but now you are the people of God. See, there was a change. You weren't always a child of God, but now that you are a child of God, you've been entered into a new calling for your life. You now are the people of God. You were not people that had experienced mercy before and the wonderful grace of God, but now you are. And you really understand the nature of God. And you exist to do what? To declare his virtue. That's it. Verse 9 again. You are a chosen people. A royal priesthood. That means God has called you to represent him in religious service and duty. To bring people as an intercessor before God. A holy nation. A people belonging by God that you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his wonderful light. See, we exist to declare the praises of God. That's it. That's why we live. To declare the praises of God in a dying culture. Holiness reflects the character of God to the world. It reflects the ownership of God, the fact that God owns us to the world. Thirdly today, in your notes, holiness exchanges sinfulness for God's will. Go over to chapter 4 here in 1 Peter, and we're just going to read verses 1 to 3 to begin. Therefore, since Christ suffered in his body, arm yourselves also with the same attitude, because he who has suffered in his body is done with sin. As a result, he does not live the rest of his earthly life for evil human desires, but rather for the will of God. For you have spent enough time in the past doing what pagans choose to do, living in debauchery, lust, drunkenness, orgies, carousing, and detestable idolatry. Holiness in your life is not going to win a popularity contest. It just won't. You want to be popular today, then you can't be holy. You're not going to be popular if you're holy. You know, when you're young especially, you want to be popular. You want to fit in. And I remember experience I had back when I was in eighth grade. Now understand that when I was in eighth grade, I was under 100 pounds. Hard to believe. I was under 100 pounds. I was 12 years old at that time. Because I entered high school when I was 13. 12 years old, under 100 pounds, I was about 90 pounds. And I was out on the football field getting thrown around. And I got into a tussle with another guy. His name was Roddy. Roddy was 16. He shaved. He had a car. He had his driver's license. In eighth grade. And I mean, you know what the difference between a 12-year-old and a 16-year-old boy. I mean, there's a big difference, right? Well, I got in a tussle with him, and somehow, and I don't know what happened to me, but I ended up holding on to Roddy's shirt. Well, it was like this. And he had a hold of my shirt, and he was threatening to do just about everything in the world with me. And everybody got around us, and they began to cheer me on. You know, go, go, you know. They weren't in the position that I was in. But you know what? I wasn't going to let go. Why? Because I wanted to be popular. I mean, I was one of the smallest kids in my grade. I was not a great athlete. I was always smaller and younger than all the rest of the guys. Here was my chance to be somebody. Well, you know what would have happened if we ever got to fighting, and the coach saw it, and he broke it up, and he took care of Roddy for me. But see, the issue is this. If you want to be popular, you can't be holy. You can't be holy. The world has no toleration for holy people. See, look at verse 1 of chapter 4. What is this attitude or mindset that Jesus had? Therefore, since Christ suffered in his body, arm yourself also with the same attitude, because he who has suffered in his body is done with sin. What's he talking about? Verse 4. Here's the suffering in the body in relationship to being done with sin that they're talking about. Verse 4. They think it strange that you do not plunge with them into the same flood of dissipation. What's the flood of dissipation? Those are those things that he lists in chapter 4, verse 3, the verse right above. You spent enough of your time in the past doing what pagans used to do, debauchery, lust, drunkenness, orgies, carousing, and detestable idols, idolatry, what's on TV on a normal night. But he says, they think it's strange that you don't plunge with them into the same flood of dissipation, and they heap abuse on you. See, are you prepared to have people abuse you because you're standing up for the truth? Or are you more concerned about being popular? We're to have the same attitude as Christ Jesus. Why did he get crucified? Because he was a nasty individual? Because he participated in wickedness and sin? Is that why he got crucified? See, that's why they crucified criminals. Because of the wrong that we were doing. But why did they crucify Christ? Because he was good. Because he was righteous. Because he stood up for the righteous things of God. I don't know what happened when you got saved, but when I got saved, when I came to know Christ, even right before I came to know Christ, all my friends, they would talk, we'd be sitting in the bar, chugging the beers and drinking the drinks, and I'd be telling them about Christ and telling them what I'm learning in the Bible. And it took me a period of about 6 months from the time I started reading the Bible to where I actually came to the place of getting saved. And I would talk to people about Christ, and they enjoyed talking with me about him. They enjoyed talking about the things of the Bible. Then I got saved. And when I got saved, when I came to know Christ, my life changed and changed radically. And I tried to talk to those same friends, and guess what? They weren't interested. They wanted nothing to do with me. Why? Because I wasn't doing those things that we were doing before. And they thought that I was becoming a little strange. Peter's saying here is that when you come to a time in your life where you're done with sin, then and choose to live the rest of your life in the pursuit of holiness, you're going to be considered strange. Will your wife make fun of you? Absolutely. Will your husband make fun of you? Absolutely, if they're unsaved. Will your friends make fun of you? Absolutely. And you have to get prepared for that. If we're going to be witnesses in this community, you have to get prepared for the abuse. But it has to begin when you have said, according to what it says in chapter 4, verse 1, that you are going to have the same mindset, is what it means, the same attitude as Christ himself, which is what? He is done with sin. He is done with sin. He's finished with sinning. And what he's talking about here, he's not talking about living in absolute perfection. We know that it is only Christ, as my granddaughter said, that is absolutely holy, absolutely perfect. We won't be absolutely holy and perfect, that any good deed that we do, we will be tainted with some sin, because as long as we're in the body, there's some imperfection there. But what he's talking about is having a mindset, the way that we think, and settling those issues in our hearts and minds in relationship to the holiness of God, and saying, I've come to a place in my life where I'm done. I'm not going to mix the two. I'm not going to stand on the fence. I'm not going to be double-minded any longer. But I'm going to choose the mindset of Christ. And what's going to happen? Well, Paul said, all that live godly in Christ Jesus will suffer persecution. And it's going to happen, it's going to come, and it probably isn't going to be anything like it was in the first century. And you're probably just going to have a little verbal abuse, or people are going to think you're strange. That's okay. And Christ suffered because he exchanged sinfulness for holiness, evil desires for doing the will of God. And remember that Jesus said, if they persecuted me, they will persecute you also. When's the last time you've been made fun of because your testimony of Jesus Christ. I've been thinking about this in relationship to my company. And I've got like, about 15 employees or so. And I know they think I'm strange, but I've been thinking about this, and I think it's time in my life where they think I'm a little stranger. And I think it's time for me to take my holiness to a new level as I live it out before them. They need to think I'm really strange. Well, Madden's description of holiness doesn't fit you, and I think it should. I love his description because he covers a lot of issues in the Christian life in a positive way. But I think it's time that you spend some time before the Lord and some soul searching and ask God, say, God, where is it in my life that holiness and your character does not match me? I think the finality of Peter's words in this passage of Scripture, several places, he's done with sin. He does not spend the rest of his earthly life. You've spent enough time in the past. You don't plunge with them. In other words, it's over. I'm done. I'm finished. A new life of holiness has begun. And you know what? You're never going to be happy as a Christian, and you're never going to grow into the full dimensions of the representation that God has for your life and your family until you get to the place where you say, I'm done. I'm cleaning up my act. There are things in my life that I shouldn't be doing, that I will not do anymore. And there are things in my life that I need to begin to do as God's representative in this earth. And in the end, I am prepared for people to think that I'm a little bit odd and a little bit strange. Where does all that begin? It begins in the mind. It's the mindset. It's the attitude. That's what it means. It begins in the mind. Paul said in 2 Corinthians 10:5 that we take every thought captive to make it obedient to Christ. You say, you don't understand how I have these temptations. And you don't understand what causes me to fall because I have these things going on in my mind. It's time to begin to deal with the issues of your mind. And when your mind begins to take you to places that your mind ought not go, that's where you cut it off. Because once you start entertaining sinful thoughts and wrong ideas and wrong thinking in the mind, it eventually is going to manifest in your actions. You take it obedient to Christ because why? You're done with sin. You've had enough. You're going to change. I love the way that Puritan William Ames said it. He was dealing with this whole issue of holiness and having a passion for holiness and settling it before God. Holiness is the result of obedience. We dealt with that last week. Obedience is the result of faith. Faith is the result of grace. By grace, by understanding the mercy of God, God in his grace brings faith into our lives. And then the works of obedience, and then we're saved. By the way, we're saved. We're done with that part. We're saved. We're considered 100% righteous, 100% holy before God. And we're considered 100% set apart for the purposes of God. And then after faith, in these works of obedience, he said, add life and meaning to faith. See, we can have faith, and we can believe and trust, but nobody can see that. But the works of obedience add life and meaning to that faith that we have. And then holiness flows out of that obedience. That's where holiness comes. That's why we're so big about reading the Scripture and studying the Scripture and taking the Scripture and spending enough time to meditate on it so that you learn to apply it to all aspects of your life. If you're here today, it's time to settle the issue before God. Do you have a passion for holiness? Do you want to be known as a holy person? Make this profession before God today. I unapologetically will pursue holiness, and I will let my holiness shine as God's representative. Lord, set me on fire so that the rest of my friends and family can watch me burn. Let your light so shine before men that they see your good works and they glorify your Father in heaven. That's what it's all about. That's a powerful witness for Jesus Christ. But you have to make that decision today. I'm going to be holy. I'm going to be holy because God is holy. And I'm And I've been called and I've been chosen as his witness. And I'm going to reflect his image, his character, his righteousness, his goodness, and his love to this dying world. Do you want to be known as holy? Do you want to be holy today? That's where it begins. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your word. Thank you for bringing faith through your mercy into each of our lives and enabling us to believe on you and trust in you. Thank you for the righteousness that you've given us in Christ Jesus. But Lord, today, that it may go a step farther, that in obedience, as we look at our lives and we look at our culture, that we would look at your kingdom. And we look at the principles in Scripture and say, Lord, I'm going to be obedient to those. I don't care what my friends say. I don't care what the society says. I don't care what the TV says or the books. I don't care what Oprah says. Lord, I am concerned about your word, your holiness, and your righteousness. And Lord, I'm done with sin. I'm done today, Lord. Lord, help me pursue the positive aspects of your kingdom. Help me to be righteousness and have a righteous mindset, not a sin mindset. Help me pursue goodness and love and kindness, and help me to do it in front of this world. Help me to be your representative, that we may bring the wonderful good news of the gospel of grace to this city, to these people, to our families, and to our friends. And Lord, that you would help us in every way to have the image, the life, and the character of Jesus Christ within us. In his name we pray.